Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grodi, your host. Tonight is an episode of The Journey Home in which I've invited back a former guest. In fact, we were just talking. It's been more than 15 years since Ken Hensley joined me on the program. He's a former Baptist minister. Now he does work, actually, for the Coming Home Network, so it's good to have him here. But one of the reasons I like to invite former guests back is that one of the things we find out when we have to condense our journey into this little hour, or maybe a half hour, to leave time for other questions. And then years later, we think, well, there was something I didn't say, or maybe the more important thing is that over the years, the Holy Spirit helps us look back and reappreciate things that happened in our journey that opened our hearts to the walk with Jesus Christ in the church that we didn't even recognize early on. So, Ken, welcome to The Journey Home. Welcome back to The Journey Home. Thank you, Marcus.
Good to be here.
It's really good to have you here. And a public statement that it's also good to have you doing work with the Coming Home Network, because you bring a lot of gifts to that work. And maybe we'll talk a little bit about that later in the program. What I'd like to do is get out of the way, as that's my job, to invite you to revisit your story of how the Lord opened your heart to the church.
Okay. Well, I'm happy to do that. I was going to say, sometimes we change our story over the years, too, just to make it sound better, you know? Make it more interesting. Well, let's see, where am I supposed to begin?
How way
I
came back.
To the way back.
Moses.
Okay. Okay, here's how I came to Christ, to begin. I was 21 years old. I was a rock and roll musician. I played guitar and sang in a band in Southern California. The band had broken up, and I moved up to Lake Tahoe to become a card counter. I was going to become Rain Man, you know, I was going to be a professional card counter, and I went up there to learn blackjack and to do that kind of thing. Anyway, during that time, I learned that probably my best friend on earth had become a Christian. I heard it. And I initially responded something like Richard Dawkins. Really, I mean, I responded, oh, you know, poor guy, couldn't handle the real world, you know, he's flown off into fairyland, you know, and I thought, I don't want to bother him. If this is making him happy, I just don't want to bug him, that kind of thing. But the next time I saw him, and I spent a little time with him, I could just see that something dramatic had happened to him, that something had changed him, you know, in a fundamental way. And he and I began to talk about it. So we began to go on long walks through in Riverside, California, and talk about Christianity, talk about Christ, talk about the case to be made for Christianity. I started reading books by well-known apologists at the time, like maybe you remember the book Evidence That Demands a Verdict by Josh McDowell. I gobbled that one down. And
yeah, two volumes, actually.
Yeah. Yeah.
More evidence that demands
Although the second volume was all about form criticism and higher critic. Anyway, read C.S. Lewis's book, Mere Christianity, and some other books like that. And I was hiding this from everyone I knew because I didn't want to be laughed at. Then I began reading the New Testament, alone in my bedroom, basically hiding from the world. I was like Gideon down in the, you know. Anyway, I read through the Gospels, and you know, a lot of it was familiar to me because I'd gone to church some as a kid. And but Marcus, it was really about the time I got to the Book of Ephesians, I think, something just began to really hit me, and it was really the Apostle Paul's life. Here he was, you know, breathing out threats and murders against the Christians, going into houses, rounding them up, you know, standing by as they're put to death. And suddenly I'm reading these letters he wrote after he was changed. And, you know, it's Paul, a slave of Jesus Christ, to the saints and faithful brethren, and how I love you in the truth, you know, and, you know, I have you always in my heart, and I'm praying. And it was the change that happened in his life. It's as though the Spirit of God just grabbed me sitting there in my bedroom alone and just said to me, this is real, you know. And I literally sat bolt upright and I said to myself, this stuff's true. You know, Christianity is true. And that's how it began, you know. From then on, I just became kind of I had started to college three times and dropped out because I was just a wild guy playing guitar and screwing around, didn't know what I wanted to do. And anyway, the Lord screwed my head on at that point, and I just wanted to study the Bible, and I wanted to study theology, and I wanted to study apologetics. And I began building a library and kind of going nuts, and I went back to college, and and then went on, you know, from there into Bible College. I got a degree in Bible and theology, my undergraduate degree. And then I went to Fuller Theological Seminary in Pasadena and got a master's degree in biblical studies. And then I went into a doctoral program at Claremont Graduate School. And I'm not sure how long I'm supposed to.
It's good. No, that's fine. It's fine.
Without you throwing in something, if you have something to say.
No.
Yeah, I was in a doctoral program. I thought I was on an academic kind of route. That's what I really loved, you know.
Now, had you served as a pastor at all?
No.
Okay, so you're studying and...
Yeah, I'm just studying. I thought I'd become a professor of biblical studies, something like that. And I was invited to come and serve at a church as an associate pastor. And it was one of those times when I was kind of tired of reading, and I thought, I'll take a little break and do something practical. Well, you take a little break, and then suddenly you're in the church, and suddenly you're in ministry. One thing led to another. I was ordained, and I wound up being a pastor for about 11 years.
Wow. Okay.
Basically, if you think of evangelical Protestant, you've got it. You know, I was associated with a Baptist denomination, but if you think of Southern California evangelical Protestant, that's what I was doing.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. So you're... you know, I remember when I had my adult conversion, the part of it was that the Holy Spirit had placed in my heart was a desire to help other people have the same experience of changed life. Was that kind of what was driving you during that time?
Yeah, well, you know, on the one hand, I had my love of the Bible and the study of theology and wanting to teach it. And on the other hand, I had this love of being involved and having a practical outworking of my Christian life, you know. And you know how it is when you get too deep into academics, then you just start yearning for a practical life. And, you know, so that's what I did. And I remained a theologian in the sense that I didn't preach on a scholarly level. I tried to preach all those years in a way that people would understand. But I continued to study and to read.
Where was the Catholic Church at all up to this point in your life?
I didn't think much about it. I had read a few of the crazy books, you know, the Church is the Whore of Babylon and whatnot. And I was really into Jonathan Edwards as a theologian. And Jonathan Edwards did not have a very high view of Catholicism. None of the Puritans did. Yeah. And so on the one hand, I read them.
And likely they never met a Catholic in their entire lives. In New England Puritanism, there was no Catholics at all. But
yeah. So I read them, and I might have kind of laughed at the things they said as they mocked the Catholic Church and all that. But I really wasn't deeply anti-Catholic. In fact, a friend of mine had invited me out to a Benedictine monastery for a spiritual retreat one time. And I'd gone out there, this is right after seminary, and I loved the place. I loved chanting the Psalms with the monks. I loved everything about it, really, you know. And I began to go out there for retreats on a regular basis. And there was a sort of this cognitive, I guess, wall or dissonance in my head. On the one hand, if someone had said to me, "What do you think of Catholic theology?" I would have said, "Oh, they're crazy, they're a cult, they're like Mormonism." But on the other hand, I loved being there, and I kept going. I was drawn to the beauty, and I was drawn to really everything about it.
Was that what started the journey then for you?
Looking back, I can say that, but no, because it was years and years. I mean, I never gave a thought to... You know, the question, could Catholicism be true? That never crossed my mind during that whole time. No, I was an evangelical pastor and studying my Bible and preaching expository sermons every week for years and years.
I'm guessing, like so many evangelicals, salvation had to do with your relationship with Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
It didn't matter what church you were in.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, so even the idea of becoming Catholic, you wouldn't even consider that, because really it's about Jesus. As long as you got Jesus, it really doesn't matter. I assume.
Yes. That's where I was at. I mean, I was always in flux in the sense that I was always questioning whether the school of theology I was in was exactly the right one. You know, like, you know, maybe the Lutherans or maybe the Methodists have this or that and all that. But it wasn't dramatic, really. There was an event, you know, a specific event in my life that caused me to think about Catholicism.
I
want to check, first of all, if I say the name Scott Hahn, is there like an ejection?
In the old Groucho Marx show, a little bird comes down and says, "You've said the magic word." But Scott has had such an influence on so many. But
Well, here's what happened. And this is a funny, it still makes me laugh. But I met Scott Hahn when I was in seminary at Fuller Theological Seminary in about 1981 or two. Scott had come to Fuller because he was considering doing doctoral work there. He had just graduated from Gordon-Conwell. Mm-hmm. and I was his host. So he spent a week or two in California, and we spent a week or two basically driving around in a car together and talking nonstop about biblical studies, because I was reading a lot of the same books he was reading. We were listening to the same theologians. We were in many ways on the same wavelength theologically. And so we really hit it off. We talked a lot. He left. He went back to the East Coast and decided not to come to Fuller. And so we just sort of faded off, you know. And so
at that time, he would have been as vehement Calvinist, Reformed, Covenant, even on the borderline of theonomy. I mean, he was very much into...
Yes, he was. And he went back to the East Coast and became a Presbyterian minister.
Right.
And he and I maybe talked a few times over a year and then just faded away. He became a Catholic about 5 years later, and I knew nothing about it. So here I go into the ministry, and I'm pastoring a church in the Glendale area of Southern California. And I'd been senior, and I was a senior pastor of this church, and a gentleman comes to me on a Sunday night, and he says, Pastor Ken, I've been debating with this group in San Diego called Catholic Answers. And I didn't know who they were.
Right.
And I didn't know why he was debating with them. You know, like I said, my church wasn't anti-Catholic. I didn't focus on it or even talk about it. And he says, they've sent me some written materials kind of over my head. And I'm wondering if you would take a look at this stuff, you know, and show me where the Catholics were wrong, that kind of thing. And then he dropped the bomb. He says, and I've got a set of tapes they gave me by some guy named Scott Hahn called Answering Common Objections Against the Catholic Faith. And I'm just sitting there like, yeah, I'm probably looking like you're looking right now. I was just thinking, there's no way on earth that this is the same guy. It's not possible. It's not possible. And so I said, you know, where are those tapes? And he said, don't worry, Pastor Ken, they're at home. I'll bring them next week. And I said, no. I said, where do you live? And I got in my car and followed him to his house, gave me the tapes, walked outside. It's like a little scene from a movie. I remember going under the street lamp and looking at the tapes before I got in my car and flipping them over and seeing Scott's face on the back. And it's going like, what? No way. I get in my car. These are cassette tapes. Do you remember those?
Oh, yeah.
My cassette tape player is broken. So I get in my car, and I can't listen to it. So I just drive like 150 miles an hour home. I go into the corner of my living room. I sit down in the rocking chair in the corner. I put on headphones so that my dear wife won't know what I'm listening to.
Yep.
And I put in this tape called Protestant Minister Becomes Catholic. I listen to it. I get off, take off the headphones. Tina says, so what's Scott saying? And I said, oh, he's become Catholic. Went to bed. Okay, two thoughts were in my, well, several thoughts, but mainly two. I had this thought, I think I can answer everything he raises in this tape. I don't think there's an issue here. I think he's wrong. I think I can answer it. But then I had these like lurking questions. One was, Ken, how could you have gone as far as you have in your education and not know more about the case that is made for the Catholic faith? Hmm. You know, because I was a serious student. I was, you know, one of those.
Yeah.
And I had continued to be a serious student all my years as a pastor. I was constantly reading everything. How could you not know more about the case, even though you think you can answer it? How come you don't know the case? And then the other question that was in my mind was, how did someone as smart as I remember Scott to have been become stupid? I mean, he's not old enough to have Alzheimer's. You know, senility is probably not the issue. So the next day, I drove to my office, back to my Baptist church, and I went into my office and I locked the door of my Baptist pastor's office, and I hunted Scott down and got him on the phone, you know, essentially say, Scott, this is Ken, remember me? And yeah, and Scott, are you wearing a diaper? I mean, what happened to you? What happened? So a little conversation began.
I laugh because it parallels my own experience. Exactly. I don't want to go into having known Scott, never believed for a moment it was true. Either he's flipped or he's lying. He sneaked into the church, you know, to try and convert. There's no way
I could have imagined.
Yeah, right. So
he's lost his mind, something like that.
Yeah.
But, you know, I called Scott on the phone, and we began to talk a little bit. And All I can say looking back now, there's one thing that I say looking back that I wouldn't have said when I was on the Your Show about 18 years ago, is I thank God from the bottom of my heart that He gave me curiosity, that He put a curiosity in me. Because I have talked to so many evangelicals since that time who just aren't curious.
Yeah.
You tell them your story, or you even make an argument, and they're just not curious. They just walk away and go, "Oh, that's fine." But I really like my church. Me and Jesus is fine, and so. But
it's the mystery of grace.
Yeah,
it really.
That God just dropped this little thing into me, and I became curious. I realized pretty quickly that Scott was a busy guy, and I also realized that I had a lot that I wanted to learn. And so I remember saying to Scott at one point, "Look, just recommend about 10 or 20 books that you think are the most important, and I'll take it from here." And anyway, for 3.5 years after that, I began to study and to listen to every taped debate I could find and read, and make my way and toward the Catholic faith. And
and here you are. A couple things.
Because
if folks want to know the rest of the story, you can go online and see your original appearance here. Although your story's probably been written up somewhere too, I imagine, if it hasn't been in our newsletter or someplace.
No, there's a CD floating around.
There you go. There you
at
go.
Lighthouse or Catholic, someone has it.
Very good. It's very common, the guests on the Journey Home, the early church fathers always have something to do with it.
Yeah.
Was that a part? Did they play a part?
Actually, you've just hit on one of the major ones, because one of the people, I knew at a certain point, when I say curious, I knew that I needed to go back and I needed to rethink my entire worldview, basically, in terms of Scripture, what Scripture teaches, what I should think of Scripture, and also history. And I began to read John Henry Newman's writings, and Newman was big for me, and as I know he's been for many, many people. I read his personal story, his conversion story. I read his book, his essay on the development of Christian doctrine, and it was hearing him say things like, to be deep in history is to cease to be Protestant. That's quite a challenge, right?
Yeah.
And he even goes further. He said at another point, it's easy to show that the early church was not Protestant. And then my favorite of all, he says something, this is a very loose paraphrase, but somewhere he says, if such a system of doctrine as Protestants believe existed in the early church, it has been completely swept away from the pages of history as if by a deluge. It's gone. You can't find it. It's as though Noah's flood came through and just washed it away. And I took that as a major challenge, and I began to read the early fathers of the church, just sort of straight through, in chronological order as much as it can be known. And yes, I was just blown away by how Catholic they sound and how Catholic they feel. I mean, the smell is Catholic, right? They're talking about their bishops in all the major cities. They're talking about altars in the church. Their description of sacraments is always one of God's grace actually being given through this, rather than simply being symbolized. And on and on and on. I remember
the real presence in the Eucharist.
Yeah. So I mean, the real presence in the Eucharist, baptismal regeneration. I remember coming home at one point and saying to my wife, this is probably 2 or 3 years into it, but saying to Tina, I said, honey, I've been crawling around in the early church for a long time. I said, I've looked under every rock. I've looked behind every tree. And I said, there's not a Baptist in sight. I can't find a Baptist. So yeah, church history was a big one for me. And then also rethinking, Scripture and in terms of what it teaches. And I suppose most people that come on here get to the issue of authority at some point. You want to talk about that?
Our guest is Ken Hensley, for those of you who are listening on radio. You mentioned Scripture. Often our guests will say, wow, I never saw this verse before, or I never understood it this way before, and often, even as an evangelical Protestant, there were verses that I avoided because they didn't quite fit my theology, but then later they made sense. Mm-hmm. Any verses like that jump out at you from your journey? They had a big place to play on your journey. I know if you listen to Scott Hahn's original tape, that was all how Scripture opened his heart to the church in many ways.
Yeah, it was one thing after another. And the issue of authority, when I think Scott mentions the fact that someone in class had said to him, where does the Bible exactly teach that the Bible alone is to serve, I'm not sure. Maybe it's just because I'm looking back after so many years and I don't tell the story very often now, I haven't done it in a while, that I don't even remember a lot of the details, but I don't remember passages that I had thought, that I'd focused on and thought, wow, this doesn't make any sense to me, and then it made sense. At least nothing's jumping out like that. Yeah. But I can say that there are passages that had been, that I just hadn't thought about, that suddenly jumped up. You know, I mean, for instance, I mentioned baptismal regeneration a moment ago. You know, in my circles, the debate was simply, are you a Baptist? Do you believe that only those who come to a personal profession of faith in Christ should be baptized? Or are you a Presbyterian, and you think that the infant children of believers should be baptized? But both just took baptism to be a symbolic action. Right. It didn't do anything. You know, it wasn't a sacrament by which grace was actually conveyed in any way. And yet, as I'm reading the early fathers, and I'm reading the way they talk about baptism, then as I'm reading through the book of Acts, you know, and Ananias says to Paul, arise and be baptized and wash away your sins. You know, suddenly that verse kind of jumped up. Now, it wasn't as though before that I looked at that verse and thought, what is this? You know, I just don't remember that really. But it suddenly jumped up. Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins. It was more the realization of, I would never talk that way as a Baptist. You wouldn't find me talking that way. And in Acts chapter 2, Peter's first sermon, where he comes to the climax of his sermon, and they say, they're cut to the heart, what must we do? And he says, repent and be baptized, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And I'm scratching my head and thinking, is he saying that the gift of the Holy Spirit will be given to these people in baptism? I never even thought of that before. And yet, this is how the fathers took it. Another passage that began to really strike me was Acts chapter 15, the first council, and referred to as the Council of Jerusalem. Because...
maybe give the audience a background of that. Why did they have this council? What was going on? What was the problem?
There were some Jewish believers up in the area of Antioch and Syria that were saying that in order for Gentiles to be saved, that they had to be circumcised, and they had to keep the customs of Moses, which would have involved, you know, purification and food laws and whatnot, okay? And they were saying, you must do this in order to be saved. They were essentially preaching, in order for Gentiles to be saved, they need to become Jews. They need to become Jewish Christians. And so a council was held, a gathering. The apostles and other leaders of the church met in Jerusalem, and they talked, and they debated, and they discussed this issue back and forth, and they came to a decision. And the thing that struck me was they wrote this decision down in a letter, and they sent this letter out to the churches. And the churches didn't respond by saying, well, you know, thank you for your opinion. We will study the Bible and make our own decision as to what we think on this, you know, this issue. Instead, it says that they received the letter with joy. And the letter said, it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to not lay anything upon you but this. In other words, the letter describes the decision they had come to as being the description of the Holy Spirit. And basically, when I put that passage together with what I saw in the emerging church of the first century, second century, third, and fourth, it fit.
Yeah. That experience of Acts 15 in my journey hit me too. Mm-hmm. And actually, what hit me, I remember after reading Newman's, the essay on the development of doctrine and getting his concepts.
Yeah.
And then looking at this passage, this actually happened. What hit me was those Jewish believers were essentially the Bible-only folk of the time. In other words, they were saying, this is what the Old Testament, this is what it says. At all times, men are to be circumcised.
Right.
We've got to follow that. Whereas the leadership of the church that Christ had appointed, guided by the Holy Spirit, had the authority to recognize that the tradition that they're following from Christ is bigger than just the written word. The authority extends beyond, as Paul says in 2 Thessalonians, stands on the tradition, whether delivered orally or written.
Right, right, right. Yeah, and that there's some ability for development. So for a new question to be raised, well, what about these Jewish rites? What about the Mosaic traditions? Yeah. And for an answer to be given that you couldn't have found if you were just studying what was Scripture at the time. Yeah.
And you could have seen that the people if they were a, quote, Bible only. In other words, this mm-hmm. is what the written word that we've read. That when the church changes it, they could have been in horror.
Right.
They could have been, yeah. no, this is what it said. Uh-huh. This is yeah. what Moses said. Yeah. And they received it with joy, recognizing the authority that were given to the apostles.
There are a couple things about this Bible only. Back to baptism for just a second. Yep. I was thinking to myself, see, because I had a Presbyterian minister that I really admired at one point, and I'd kind of come under his wing, and he was tutoring me, and he wanted me to become a Presbyterian. And so I had gone into this study of baptism. That is it believer's baptism, the Baptist view, or is it infant baptism? I'd gone into it in depth, and I couldn't decide. In a way, I came away going, you know what? Based on the passages in the New Testament, I just don't know if I can prove one position or the other. I mean, I could lean one way or I could lean the other, but can I prove it? And then when I saw what was in the early fathers, you know, as I said, and suddenly baptismal regeneration starts to leap off the pages of the New Testament in many, many places, what that drove home to me was, based on the Bible alone, you could be the smartest guy on earth. You can pray, you can search the scriptures, and you could have a genius Lutheran say one, you know, come out one way, and a genius Methodist come out another way, and a genius Presbyterian, a genius Baptist. It's just not, these things are not provable on the basis of Scripture alone. You know, so that's one thing that came to me. And then the issue of the
which affirms that that was not what the Bible was for in the first place. It wasn't intended to be this answer book or the
I don't think so. And then the coup de grace in this whole thing, of course, is the fact that the church in councils, just like the council in Jerusalem, moving forward over the succeeding centuries, actually made the final decision as to what books to even call the Bible, and which books to put in the Bible. Yeah. And, you know, at the time I studied, there's a Protestant, well-known biblical scholar named Bruce Metzger, and his book on the canonization of the New Testament and whatnot. And he had said in there, he had admitted that about 25% of the books in the New Testament were in dispute to one degree or another in the early centuries, not the early years, not the early decades, but the early centuries of the church. And that the decisions were made, you know, the councils of Hippo and Carthage in the late 4th century and whatnot, that these were made. At the time, I was meeting with Jimmy Akin. I don't remember how we became friends, but what a great guy Jimmy was, you know.
He still is.
Beautiful. Yeah. Jimmy used to drive up from San Diego, and I would drive down, and we would meet halfway and have lunch together, and we would talk about these issues, you know. And I think it was him that posed that great horns of a dilemma question. He said, Ken, we were talking about these councils, and he said, do you believe that the Holy Spirit led the church in those councils to a decision that is true and that is binding and that should not be up for discussion? Yes or no? And, you know, it was the horns of a dilemma, the Protestant horn. I mean, the Protestant dilemma was right there in front of my eyes. If I say yes, I believe the Holy Spirit led the church in those councils to a decision that is binding and true, and I received this canon that they gave. Then Jimmy says, welcome to the Catholic Church. You're a Catholic. You're basically a Catholic. Yeah. If I say, in good Protestant fashion, if I say, no, these are fallible men, these councils are fallible. I agree with Martin Luther, you know, each man is his own church and council, you know, I don't trust in popes and councils and all that. If I say no, I do not believe necessarily that they were led to a true decision, then Jimmy can say to me, oh, well, then you have a bigger problem than you thought you had. It's not just a matter of you interpreting the Bible for yourself. You're going to have to construct your own Bible, Ken. And how are you going to do it? You're going to go back to the 3rd and 4th century and 1st century, and are you going to dig into the evidence, and are you going to be smarter than they were back then? Are you going to decide whether this book is in or out, or whether the books that were excluded should be included, like the Epistle of Barnabas or Ignatius or whatever? And so it was that issue that basically was the crux of my conversion, was the realization that, you know, and I remember at one point that this kind of little illustration came into my mind. I thought, Ken, if you could be parachuted back into the 3rd century, and you land there, and you look around, and this is unhistorical what I'm saying, but, you know, like Cyprian is over here, and Augustine's over here, and these other guys are here, would you have joined them? Or would you have said, I stand aloof. You guys may be right on some things, but you're wrong on other things. I'm going to form my own church. It's going to be called the Ken Hensley denomination. What would you have done? And I just immediately knew I would join them. I mean,
and there you are.
what level of arrogance would it be for me to say, I'm starting my own church?
Yeah,
that's how I felt.
And sadly, that's that kind of arrogance, a strong word, but the truth of it is every 5 days a new church starts here in America somewhere.
And you don't feel like you're being arrogant. A person just feels like they're trying to be truthful to the text.
Yeah, everybody's got it wrong, or they don't seem to say it that way. So that, I really believe I want to go back to Acts chapter 2 and make the right church. Mm-hmm. So that happens at least every 5 days in America. Let's pause there, Ken, and we'll come back. I want to talk about your struggles after coming into the church, which connect a lot with our work in the Coming Home Network. So we'll come back and come up with that. See you then. Welcome back to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grodi, your host, and our guest is Ken Hensley. As I mentioned before the break, I want to talk a little bit about your continual journey after coming in. And, mm-hmm. and I'm going to take this moment, I don't always do this, but to help the audience know that my main job isn't the Journey Home program, it's Coming Home Network, which is a lay apostolate that helps, particularly exists to help non-Catholic Christians, lay as well as clergy, mm-hmm. Discover the beauty of the church. And a good part of our work is helping particularly clergy go through the rough road into the church. Mm-hmm. Because like you were saying, you were listening in your living room to your headphones or in the privacy of your car to a convert of a clergyman, mm-hmm. because you didn't at that time, sure, your wife wanted to hear or your congregation or your friends. And so our work is often helping clergy recognize the impact that becoming Catholic is going to have on your vocation, your occupation, your marriage, your friendships, mm-hmm. and for some it's a tough time.
Yeah. By the way, when you mentioned the Coming Home Network, something popped into my mind. I was talking earlier about the fact that I loved academics, but I also wanted to be in ministry and that kind of being torn and which way to go. I actually have the best of both worlds in my life right now because I work for the Coming Home Network, which means that I'm in touch with and going to be in touch in a pastoral way much more with real people who are coming into the faith and need help and need encouragement and prayer answers. Yeah. But I also teach part-time at St. John's Seminary for the Archdiocese of Los Angeles in the Biblical Studies Department. So I teach Old Testament, I teach New Testament, and I'm developing a course on Catholic apologetics I'll be teaching next year. So I kind of get to do both now, so I'm happy about that. But trouble, okay. The troubles began the second I took the headphones off. Hmm. And when my wife said, what's Scott saying? Because I think now looking back that as soon as I said, oh, Scott's become Catholic, I think she said, you're not gonna become Catholic, are you? but you know, I can look back on this whole thing and laugh now as many, many years, but it was torment. We had a situation in the church that I was pastoring that was really the dream that a pastor could have. I mean, I had a very, very enthusiastic congregation of people who loved Tina and loved me, who didn't want me going to meetings 6 and 7 nights a week, as some pastors can end up doing, wanted me spending a lot of time with my family and prayer and study and all that. I could have been there the rest of my whole life. I didn't think about money. I was never going to be rich, but I knew my paycheck was in the box every 2 weeks, and that's all there is to it. Yeah. And my wife had developed, we both had, but especially she had developed some close friendships there that meant a lot to her. And so when she began to perceive that I was actually thinking about Catholicism, it was just absolutely a shock. It was as though, it was as though her Protestant minister husband came home one day and said, hey, you know, maybe the atheists are right, you know, or maybe the Mormons are right or something. She had no desire, no interest, and no desire whatsoever, you know, to deal with it. And so actually for a couple of years, I'd have to say, Marcus, we couldn't even talk about what I was learning without it winding up in tears and argument of some sort and all that. It was really bad. Yeah. And I would lie, meaning that I would be studying and be drawn into what I was learning, and I would be thinking to, I'd be thinking, man, there's something here. And then I would lie to myself. As soon as I would read an argument that even came close to answering the Catholics, I'd go, oh, that's great, that answers it. And I can put that away now, and I can go about my life, you know. And I would find myself, you know, shaving the truth and pretending to Tina that I wasn't as interested as I really was at times, and it was just really bad. Yeah. And I have to say, though, I did something that was pure genius by accident at one point, and I'm going to include this because it might help somebody else out there. Okay, I didn't know I was doing it, but I was collecting quotations from the early fathers that supported Catholic teaching in one way or another. And I asked Tina if she would type them up for me. I just gave her all this stuff. And I said, would you type these up for me? So she sat there during the day on the computer and started typing in the words of Ignatius of Antioch and Irenaeus and Justin Martyr on baptism, on the Eucharist, on this, on that, okay? And she began to be affected by what she was reading. And she by osmosis, kind of seeing what was happening with me and talking to me a little bit, and then these quotations, she was in the process too. And that came to a head one night at church. This is funny to me. Somehow we were talking about baptism after the evening service, a group of us in the sanctuary talking about baptism. And all of a sudden Tina pipes up, and she doesn't usually join in group conversations like this too much. She pipes up and she goes, well, Polycarp said, and blah, blah, blah. She starts quoting Polycarp like a patristic scholar, you know. And my associate pastor at the time, he says, Polycarp can go fish. You know, carp.
Yeah, right.
Polycarp can go fish. And I feel like I looked over at Tina and I almost saw this look in her eye, like a moment of conversion. I almost saw this look in her eyes like, he doesn't care what Polycarp had to say. What is going on? What is going on here? That kind of thing. Yeah. But anyway, thankfully, the struggles between me and Tina continued for a long, long time. And at one point, I remember Tina saying to me, what are you going to do? And I said, I think I have to leave. I don't think I can continue doing what I'm doing. And she said, but are you 100% sure? 100%. I was like, anyway, she talked me into waiting a while longer. She said, look, preach on subjects where Protestants and Catholics agree. Preach on very practical spiritual issues that we would all agree on. Give it one more year, she said. Study, pray, think, and if you believe we need to leave, you know, that you need to resign, then we'll do it. And I gave in. I wanted to be Catholic then. I gave in and said, okay. She leaves the room. She draws up a contract. She brought it back into the room and made me sign it. Okay, so.
Wow.
I kept my contract, and a year later, made the decision and resigned and stepped down. And by the time I resigned, I would say Tina was 80% on board, which is a real blessing. So that we both went into RCIA together, and we both came into the church together, in at Easter Vigil of 1997.
I want to talk about that because we have found in our work with Protestant ministers on the journey that 80% of the time, the spouses are at different places on that journey. Mm-hmm. And very often it's the case where the clergyman, because he usually has a seminary education, is more accustomed to reading Newman and early church fathers, and often the spouse mm-hmm. who didn't have that experience is not as comfortable reading the theological texts. Mm-hmm. So often it's the clergyman trying to figure out, how do I convey to my spouse mm-hmm. what I'm discovering by mm-hmm. Newman and Louis Bouillet and all these great writers? How do I mm-hmm. convey that? But part of the problem is not having anyone else in your life to talk to about this,
yeah,
other couples to share that with. But also in our work, sometimes the clergyman who's in this position struggles with, well, wait, now that I know that it's true, am I obligated to make this jump, even if my wife wants nothing to do with it.
Yeah.
And you, on top of that, with that struggle, were also in the pulpit every Sunday.
Yeah.
Trying to be as honest you can with your congregation, but you can't tell them what you've been discovering.
No.
Yeah. I mean, there you were. I mean, so that's part of what we deal with all the time in helping people deal with the struggle.
Well, let me come at that like this. People, when you tell your story, this is so common, people say, how courageous, okay? No. At the time, that seems to me, this is what I say to people. Look, if my house is on fire and I run out the front door, you don't typically say, you're so courageous. How do you run out that front door, you know? You know, the truth is, as a Protestant minister, as you said, one who had to be in the pulpit every week, and I had like a membership classes coming up and all that, and to me, the more conviction, you know, I had that I needed to become Catholic, the more remaining in that position felt like a man on fire, you know? It felt like I was in a burning building. So to me, it didn't feel like I'm going to do something courageous. It felt like I got to get out. I've got to go. And so I think it's helpful to me that I'm such an impractical person in a way. I don't think of the practical ramifications of things. So at the time, I just knew I was in love. I was falling in love with the church, and I wanted to become Catholic, and I didn't think about all this stuff. My wife thought much more about the fallout, you know, of what would come. And so I didn't struggle with the idea that I could stay, you know, at all. You know, it's funny, when I finally did tell the church, you know, and I had to almost blurt it out, you know, the church wanted me to remain, and I said, I'll remain here as your pastor until you can find someone if you want. And they were, yes, this is what we want. The second the denomination
heard,
you know, found out about that, you know, I was so naive, you know, I just thought, well, maybe I can do that. I think it was the very next night, I mean, I'm in my office meeting with six or seven bigwigs from the denomination, and the long and short was, do you want 1 week to say goodbye or do you want two? And I was out.
Yeah.
So I would say with Tina, though, you know, that we do talk and we can talk about things. So she was absorbing the arguments. She's not the kind to pick up, you know, a bunch of books and read them, but she was absorbing the arguments. And so on an intellectual level, she was being converted slowly. But her main struggle was totally on the personal level, was the friend she had there. And what are we going to do? And what are you going to do to make a living? And all that. And like I said, I'm kind of dumb when it comes to practical ramifications. Well, so
what did you think at all about what you were going to do at that point?
At that point, again, I'm running out of a burning building. And so I just thought, man, freedom, I'm out. I can become Catholic now. And I assumed, you know, a master's degree in biblical studies, certainly that'll open any door for you. It doesn't, right?
Right.
It doesn't. What did I end up doing? I got a job waiting tables. That's what I did at first. I was 42 years old when I converted. I felt like I was very old, you know, 42. Like, oh my, how do you start a word 42? I looked into a few things. I really would have wanted, obviously, to continue teaching and preaching and being in ministry and being in Catholic apostolate or something like that. But what I was facing was, I have a mortgage. I have my wife. We have two children. I've got these bills. I have to make money. You know, I have to make money. So obviously I become a waiter. No. I had waited tables in college and seminary, and I thought, you know, I've got white hair and I could be like a maitre d' at a real high class restaurant or something and make some good money. So I got a job waiting tables, and that didn't work very well because they put me on lunch shift. And it's so funny because it began to dawn on me slowly what I had actually done. I remember I was working the lunch shift one day, and I was standing in the kitchen, and my manager had told me to fold napkins. And I was sitting there folding napkins, and I was thinking about Martin Luther. I was working on some issue in my head, you know. I was folding napkins, and all of a sudden I heard somebody screaming. And I look over, and my manager, who was this lady who was at least a dozen years younger than me, she was standing in the door screaming at me, because I wasn't folding napkins fast enough. And I remember this thought. I apologized, and I began to fold faster. But there was sort of this thought of, you know, a year ago, I was a senior pastor. You know, I had an office. You know, I, you know, I mean, I, I, I laid out my own schedule, you know. I'd fly to a conference, you know, a pastoral conference somewhere, and I'm folding napkins, and someone's yelling at me, you know.
I'm wondering how long did it take you to look back on that and see it as the hand of God in terms of, in a positive sense, in terms of humility. You know, that famous parable of our Lord, which I know I've mentioned on the program, where the wedding feast, mm-hmm. where Jesus warns, when you go to the wedding feast, don't take the front row seat.
Right.
Take the back row seat.
Right.
Which is the advice we always give to convert clergy, to be willing. Yeah. And you took the back row seat. Not by choice, but by, that was all you had at the time.
Yeah, and when you ask how long did it take, you know, I think that I knew enough about the truth to kind of know right from the beginning that this was a good thing, that this was okay. But did I feel it? Did I enjoy it? No, I didn't. You know, it was pain. It was pain. I wound up going, well, I remember the first Christmas, I resigned in September. And the first Christmas as a waiter, you know, I had to wait tables on Christmas Eve. And I hadn't, you know, Christmas Eve for years and years and years previous, I'd been home with my family, and I had to wait tables. And so my family came down to the restaurant and got a table in my section so that I could wait on them. And that's how we could be together on Christmas Eve.
Wow.
So, you know, but the money was terrible. You know, the tips were no good. I went out to breakfast with a priest one day, and I was shaking as I was talking to him, and I just said, look, you know, you're a priest at a large congregation. You must know somebody who has a business and needs somebody, you know, to do something, you know, that someone could do, namely me. And I got a call from a guy who was a headhunter, and he invited me to come over. And long story short, I worked as a waiter for a while. I worked as a headhunter. I worked as a waiter and a headhunter at the same time, where I would run over to his house in the morning wearing my penguin outfit for my lunch shift at the restaurant and do cold calling, just absolute cold calling sales, getting into companies, trying to get contracts with them, trying to do headhunting. After that, I was a stockbroker. All along, I was doing some teaching at conferences. And here's the funny thing. I used to see Scott Hahn every year because I would be on the roster speaking at the National Catholic Family Conferences in Long Beach, and then later at the Anaheim Convention Center. And Scott would be there. And so we would run into each other every year. And we would go to lunch at some point, and Scott would look across the table and say, Ken, get your doctorate, man. Come on. You know, it was that kind of thing. And I remember every time I saw Scott, it was depressing because I would sort of hang my head and sort of trying to figure out, you know, how do I make money during the day, and how do I get a doctorate at night, and how do I get back into teaching and all that. So, you know, I to answer your question, I don't think I did very well with the whole thing. Yeah. I mean, I did my work, I made money, I supported my family, but I think I was a bit of a grumbler on a spiritual level for quite a while. I wasn't the guy that just totally accepted what the Lord was doing.
In many ways, that's one of the reasons why we're glad you're working with the Coming Home Network, because you know the struggle. Because part of the problem is that the understanding of vocation and the calling is a bit different in the non-Catholic Christian world than it is in the Catholic world. It isn't a direct transfer. You know, how do you become a priest? What's the diaconate all about? And part of the problem is that many times, like in your case, a Protestant minister becoming Catholic, most of his training was in ministry or in studies and all that. And you come into the Catholic Church, and how do you have to retool yourself at age 42 to learn a new occupation? Mm-hmm. Because you're married with kids, and a Baptist minister at that, so it isn't an automatic process for you to work with the church to become maybe a married priest, which happens at time to time.
Or a lot of people assume that you will obviously become a deacon, you know, and
well, even the diaconate, you have to have a secular job.
Yeah, and you've got to go to school for a long time. So, and I had children that were teenagers, and you know,
it's tough. Hey, we got an email in. Let's take this and
sure.
We'll maybe get back to that topic, but let's get this email. And Jack from the East Coast writes, "I'm a pastor who has begun reading about the Catholic Church, and I'm interested by what I'm finding. So many of the books make sense and are convincing. Over the past few months, I have shared a few of my findings with my wife, and she seems okay with my search. At what point do I open up to her and seriously discuss that I feel eventually I might become Catholic? And how can I encourage her to consider Catholicism too?
Well, that's kind of an easy question for me to escape, because the answer of at what point do I begin to tell her what's really happening, the answer to that question is going to be different for every single married couple on earth. You know, only Jack can know his wife and what she's like and what she knows and how difficult this process is, and therefore when to begin to say, I'm really thinking of this, you know. But, you know, I would encourage him not to press things. You know, sometimes I run into situations where, you know, people just become crazy about becoming Catholic and entering the Catholic Church. And in a sense, they end up not realizing or not caring that they're trampling over their family instead of, you know, taking time and going slowly and being really patient. So I would encourage that.
And every marriage is different. The communication levels of every marriage are different. Even depending on what non-Catholic tradition you're in, it makes it different. Some are more open to Catholicism. Some are completely anti. We work with people, even as you and I have discussed recently, with the staff, that we know men on the journey who've been warned by their wives that if you even consider it, I'll divorce you.
Right.
And so there they are. You know, and so it is, that question's an important question, and that's why there is no easy answer to it. And that's,
you know, I can apply that question to my daughter. See, at the time we came into the church, our son was about 8 years old. So we could kind of just sort of bring him along with us in a way. Our daughter, though, was a really sharp 14-year-old who was very involved in our youth group and had friends and was a sincere evangelical believer in Christ. And so she was too young to care about what is all this theological, what are you guys doing, what is all the, you know, the theological discussion. But she was too old to say, you're a Catholic now, come here. And so we really had to figure that one out. And, you know, looking back, you know, some people may disagree with this decision, but I spoke with several priests and tried to figure out the best thing to do. We actually decided that we wanted to encourage her name's Blythe, to encourage her in her walk with Christ and not demand anything. And so for a while, we actually drove her to the church I pastored and dropped her off on Sunday mornings and then picked her up. And so it felt, you know, it was driving into the parking lot and driving out when I'd been the pastor there. Very, very strange. But with her, it took about 6 or 7 years, too. She became interested slowly, and we had conversations off and on through her teen years. But it wasn't until she met the man that she ended up marrying. And he was an evangelical Protestant, too. But God put that curiosity in him. The second she told him, my father used to be a pastor, and my mother, they became Catholic. He was like, what? Why did they become a Catholic? And he was interested, and she invited him over to our house. And I remember sitting on the back porch for about 3 hours one night and describing to Kirby, is his name, explaining to Kirby why we'd become Catholic. And he was interested, and she was interested because she had been learning for years. She just couldn't do it alone. You know, young girls, they don't go to the bathroom without two or three friends with them, you know, teenage girls. So she wasn't going to become Catholic on her own. And she was involved in a large, you know, non-denominational evangelical church at the time. So she and he became Catholic together. And it was years, you know, later. And I got to throw this in because this is something I would not have thought of 18 years ago when I was on your show, or whenever it was, at all. But when I was becoming Catholic, I don't know if this applies to you, but I was focused on the truth, you know. What is true? Where should I be? And all that. I was focused on that. And then I was focused on the glory of the church, the beauty of the Catholic Church, my love for the church. I was focused on that. I didn't really think about long-term ramifications. You know, I didn't think much about what I would even do to make a living, but certainly not long-term. For instance, I didn't think that my daughter might become Catholic, that she and her husband might have this wonderful Catholic family, and that she might have 7 children now, which wouldn't have happened in the
evangelical world.
In the evangelical world, no, that wouldn't have happened. And so now I have 7 grandchildren who exist, you know, like 7 children who live about a mile and a half from me. Yeah. You know, never would have crossed my mind, Marcus, that this would be part of the result of the curiosity that God put in me and that led me into the church. So So when I'm not helping converts, and when I'm not teaching at the seminary or preparing lectures or whatnot, I have seven little guys crawling up and down my back and beating on my head.
All connected to your journey.
Yeah, it is.
Ken, thanks for your work with Coming Home Network.
Thank you.
But thank you for joining us again and sharing your story on the journey home. I really appreciate your witness for Christ and His church.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining us on this episode of The Journey Home. I do pray that Ken's journey and his struggle to seek to follow the Lord faithfully is an encouragement to you. God bless you. See you again next week.